is yours.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I would like to thank the organizing committee of this educational event for giving me the opportunity to share my thoughts about oxygen targets in patients with severe traumatic brain injury. I do not have any conflicts of interest to declare regarding this presentation, and here is the outline of my presentation. First, we will provide some introductory remarks, then we will talk about oxygen targets in the intensive care unit, and finally, we will talk about oxygen targets in the emergency department. I know that the order is a bit reversed here, but I think this is a better way to convey my message, so please hang with me. We start with the introduction. We will talk about terminology and about biological effects of oxygen. Terminology. We are Greeks. We are obsessed with language. And I think it's important to distinguish some terms. Hyperoxia may be different than hyperoxemia or tissue hyperoxia. Here is the monitor of a ventilator. The patient is receiving 100% FiO2. This is hyperoxia. So high FiO2, high fraction of inspired oxygen means hyperoxia, low FiO2 is hypoxia. This is different from hyperoxemia. The word aema means blood in Greek. So when we are talking about hyper or hypoxemia, we are referring to PaO2. Pressure of arterial oxygen. And finally, we have the tissue hyperoxia and hypoxia. For this one, we need the brain tissue oxygen tension. In this talk, we will focus on hypo and hyperoxemia, PaO2, under normobaric conditions. There are several trials exploring the effect of hyperbaric oxygen on outcomes of patients with severe TBI. But reviewing these trials is beyond the scope of this presentation. A first observation from the literature is that a universally accepted PaO2 threshold for hypo or hyperoxemia seems missing. Hypoxemia has been defined in the literature as a PaO2 less than 60, the traditional definition, or even less than 100 millimeter of mercury. Likewise, hyperoxemia has been defined as PaO2 above 200 or above 250 or even 350. So there is a variability in terms of terminology. Let's move on to biological effects of hypoxemia. Here is a study from Dr. Roba. We are glad we have her here with us today. She showed that hypoxemia, low PaO2, as a result of lung injury, led to tissue hypoxia, low brain tissue oxygen tension, and to secondary brain injury and higher mortality. And this is a nice figure showing the association between the complex association between hypoxemia and tissue hypoxia. Apart from hypoxemia, even hyperoxemia has detrimental biological effects. Here we present an experimental study showing that hyperoxemia damages endothelial cells via formation of reactive oxygen species. Hyperoxemia promotes cell death in the brain. And experimental hyperoxemia causes vasoconstriction. Now, to be accurate, I should have said hyperoxia, because what they have done here, the investigators, they provided 100% of oxygen. So this is hyperoxia, but hyperoxia causes hyperoxemia. So I think that we can extrapolate their findings to hyperoxemia. And as you can see, it is the effect of oxygen on coronary blood flow. But I think the same can happen in the brain vessels. So hyperoxemia may cause vasoconstriction in the brain and secondary brain injury. And if we want to take them together, both hypoxemia and hyperoxemia may have harmful biological effects. And this is a classical figure in a review manuscript written by Drs. Benson and Dr. Tacone. So the first messages of my presentation is that there is a variability in terminology and that both hypoxemia and hyperoxemia may cause harm. We are moving to more clinical aspects now in the intensive care unit. In the intensive care unit, hypoxemia may be harmful. And this is one study published 80 years ago. These results were confirmed by another study, similar, a bit more recent. They showed that hypoxemia alone may be harmful. If hypotension alone can be harmful, but if we combine those two conditions, hypotension and hypoxemia, then we have an even more bad outcome. So systemic hypotension may act as a confounder of the association between oxygenation and outcomes. Therefore, hypoxemia should be avoided in the intensive care unit. And actually, that was the statement of the CIBIC panel members published in Intensive Care Medicine 3 years ago. We were lucky, we had the editor-in-chief of Intensive Care Medicine talking to us before. So in that CIBIC report, it was stated that clinicians should maintain an SpO2 above 93%. But what about hyperoxemia? It seems that the intensive care unit hyperoxemia may be not beneficial. According to a large observational study conducted in Finland, where the investigators found that hyperoxemia in the first 24 hours of ICU admission is not predictive of six-month mortality. These results were confirmed in another observational study conducted in Australia and New Zealand. Again, those investigators found that hyperoxemia may be not beneficial. Actually, there might be a trend of increased mortality with hyperoxemia in patients with isolated head injury. So, in the intensive care unit, both hypoxemia and hyperoxemia may be harmful. And actually, that was the title of this observational study published several years ago and confirmed by another study, the retrospective observational study, which showed again that hyperoxemia compared to normoxemia is associated with higher mortality. On the same matter, I would like to mention this study, a secondary analysis of a randomized controlled trial involving 500 patients with severe TBI. The authors reported this figure, again the same U-shape, hypoxemia and hyperoxemia may be harmful regarding long-term functional outcome. The functional outcome was assessed by the extended Glasgow outcome scale. So this scale takes numbers from 1, death, up to 8, good outcome. If it is above 4, then the outcome is considered good. If it is below 5, the outcome is considered poor. So the investigators found that both hypoxemia and hyperoxemia were bad. And it seems the same U-shape that we saw in the biological effects, you can see in the clinical effects as well. And it seems that there is a sweet spot of PaO2 levels. But we may not know the specific optimal PaO2 levels for each patient. We do not know where this sweet spot is. And I think that in order to identify optimal PaO2 levels for each patient, brain tissue oxygen testing may be of help. And actually, that was the rationale, I think, behind this report from the CIBIC panel members, which was published 2 years ago in Intensive Care Medicine, where they recommended that the clinician should consider both intracranial pressure and brain tissue oxygen testing in order to provide management, to manage patients with a traumatic brain injury. Now, To be fair and for full disclosure, in my ICU, in the ICU where I work, we are not familiar with brain tissue oxygen attention. We lack the device, but I think it is something that we need to learn. So the second message of the presentation is that in the intensive care unit, both hypoxemia and hyperoxemia should be avoided, and that brain tissue oxygen attention may be of help. And now we go to the emergency department. During the first hours, hyperoxemia may be harmless. So this is different than what we said about the ICU. That was the conclusion of a study conducted in Japan. The investigators recorded PaO2 at a mean of 6 hours from TBI onset. And they found that there was no difference in terms of PaO2 levels between patients who had a good outcome and those who had a bad outcome. I would like to argue here that during the first hours, hyperoxemia may be even beneficial. I will base my argument on this study, which was conducted by colleagues in my division. Dr. Bretou is the first author. She will be a speaker later on, along with Dr. Giannakoulis. We performed a secondary analysis of a multicenter randomized controlled trial funded by NIH and published in JAMA 12 years ago. This trial compared the outcomes of patients with severe traumatic brain injury receiving out-of-hospital hypertonic resuscitation versus normal saline, versus resuscitation with normal saline. It was a neutral trial. They did not find any difference in terms of outcomes, but we took advantage of those data. So we had data from 910 patients with severe TBI who had a PaO2 value available during their presentation in the emergency department. And this paper is in the revision process in Annals of Emergency Medicine. This is what we found. First, hyperoxemia may be beneficial regarding survival, and actually, the more the merrier. Even more importantly, hyperoxemia, early hyperoxemia, may be beneficial regarding long-term functional outcome, again, assessed by the extended Glasgow outcome scale. So you see that the higher the PaO2, the higher the probability that the patient will have a better long-term functional outcome. That was the crude analysis. Even after adjustment for age, just remember the presentation of Dr. Citerio before. Even after adjustment for age, for papillary reactivity, for revised trauma score, we found the same results. Now, we selected these variables because they were identified by the impact investigators as major determinants of mortality. We did not have the motor component of Glasgow coma scale, so we had to use the revised trauma score, which is heavily dependent on Glasgow coma scale. The same result was found even after adjusting for hemoglobin at admission, CT scan findings, and injury severity score. So our conclusion is that in the emergency department, early on, we just need to avoid hypoxemia. And we were very satisfied to see that the same statement was made in this excellent review written by Dr. Mayfraud and colleagues and published around a couple of weeks ago in intensive care medicine. It is interesting that many of the authors here are also part of the international faculty here in Athens. So it was written that during the initial resuscitation targets, is just to avoid hypoxemia in order to avoid brain hypoxia, nothing else. So the third message is that the emergency department, we may just need to avoid hypoxemia. And the synopsis of the presentation is this slide. Both hypoxemia and hyperoxemia may have detrimental biological effects. That's why in the intensive care unit, both hypoxemia and hyperoxemia should be avoided. But in the emergency department, we may just need to avoid hypoxemia. And if we want to say just one word, as a synopsis of the presentation, this word should be individualization. Optimal oxygen targets seem to differ between patients depending on hemodynamics, comorbidities, other injuries. Brain tissue oxygenation may play a role. Also, optimal oxygen targets may differ for the same patient depending on time from TBI onset. The earlier, the higher PO2 we may want to target. I would like to acknowledge the following entities for providing me with financial support to do my research. And thank you, everyone. I will be happy to take any questions.
Thank you for your presentation. Very nice. And I am still confused. What's the best? Because we play between should be avoided, it's better, but nothing is clear. But do you have any questions from the audience? Ah, there is one question.
Great talk, thank you. Laurie Shutter from the US.
Thank you.
One issue, you talk about hypoxemia and measuring PaO2, but so often people use SaO2.
Correct.
And try to say that's the same thing. But we're seeing increasingly that SaO2 measures using regular pulse oximetry is not appropriately calibrated for darker pigmented skins.
Correct.
So a lot of the data, could you just comment on how that may be impacting both data we've been interpreting up to now and what we need to do moving forward?
Okay, excellent. I think this is an excellent point. Yes, actually, it seems that the trend in the literature is that we move from PaO2, which requires an invasive method, to SpO2. And actually, we do not have enough data to see how how we can interpret the literature. We don't know, but I think that this is what we should do in the future in terms of studies. We should take care of SpO2 as well. But the literature now is based on PaO2. That's why I mentioned these studies.
Thank you very much for the talk. I have a very practical question.
Okay.
At the early phase, when you have your patient and you don't have blood gas every 5 minutes, which are your targets for SpO2?
Okay.
For those patients, and how do you trigger your FiO2?
I'm a pulmonologist. When we made this study, the secondary analysis of this trial, I thought that hyperoxemia would be bad. Okay, as pulmonologists, we do not like a lot of oxygen. And I got surprised to see that it doesn't matter. So during the early phases in the emergency department, in the trauma bay, I think that it is better for us to err on the safe side. Just give 100% FiO2. This is what we do most of times in the emergency department or in the ambulance. It is better. Later on, when the patient goes to the ICU, we start thinking about the detrimental effects of hyperoxemia and try to adjust the FiO2. But even there, in the ICU, if we do not have a brain tissue oxygen tension, I think it's better to have a bit higher oxygen rather than lower.
Thank you. I completely agree, because at home I just always talk to my nurse and I say, I don't want to see three numbers on SpO2, but I want to see 9, 8, and 9, 9. I don't want to be lower because it goes down too fast. So we fight to have never 100, but to be between 95 and 99.
Of course, yeah. Above 95. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.